Good afternoon. I'm here to speak about scholarship, one of the four pillars of the National Honor Society. So when I was first told that I was giving this speech on scholarship, it took a while to get some inspiration. So I turned to Google. I searched up the definition, and the search engine gave me learning of a higher level. I took a moment and just stared at the definition, hoping something might spark. The famous statue, the thinker, came to mind. You know, the man sitting kind of like this, his back is bent like he has scoliosis, his chin resting on one curved hand. He looked so deep and lost in his thoughts. I thought to myself, the only thing that could make man think so hard is life. Life and man's place. He is much like a philosopher. Philosophers spend their whole life contemplating things and ideas. You could say they are lifetime scholars, learning of a higher level. So what better way to speak about scholarship than to compare it with those who are lifetime scholars, philosophers? Plato, an ancient Greek philosopher, came up with theory of forms. He believed that each thing came in three forms. First is the form you create in your minds. For example, when I say the word chair, you all probably have a mental image of a chair in your head. Since there are so many chairs in the world, the chair in your head is probably different than the person sitting next to you. Next is the physical form. So if you all look behind you and stare at the chair you are sitting on, it may or may not be the same chair in your head. They are both chairs. Last is the true form. This form is created by God, our Creator. It is only known by Him, and it is our inspiration to make chairs. So, say if there was a perfect chair, we could never know it, but only strive to. Plato claimed that this theory applied to each and everything in life. So, let's apply it to scholarship. First, the form we create in our minds. When first hearing the word scholarship, I think of a smart student. You know, the student who knows all the answers to the teacher's questions. She aces all her tests, and her name is always on the principal's list. Next, the physical form. This is similar to the accomplishments you can list on your resume. For example, all the awards you have won, programs attended, internships successfully done, etc. Hope you get the point. But although these accomplishments may seem impressive, it does not say anything about her scholarship. It does not offer a complete understanding of the student. They are just grand titles to what the student has learned. This is why the physical form is not my favorite. Our eyes can deceive us. They can only see the surface and not the depths. We must all turn in our perspective and look under the surface, because appearances do not tell everything. This is something Plato did not address in his theory of forms, that our eyes deceive us. And I'm quite disappointed in him, but proud to add to his understanding. Lastly, the true form. Scholarship is more than what you can see on the resume. It is more than just being a smart student. Scholarship means learning more, to know more. As you learn, you become capable of more learning, of making connections and seeking a deeper understanding of what you already started. You are able to achieve learning on a higher level. But we all know this process is difficult. Work is hard, and you may not always enjoy it. I know I don't, and I bet you all don't. But at the end of the day, all your hard work will pay off, I promise. You will have gained wisdom and maybe even skills or character that will help you go through life. So please do not think of scholarship as something that only applies to school. It's not all about getting good grades or gaining titles to show off. It's to know more, to gain more. The sculptor of the thinker said, "What makes my thinker think is that he thinks not with his brain, only with his knitted brow, his distended nostrils, and compressed lips." but with every muscle of his arms, back, and legs, with his clutched fists and gripping toes. Even the thinker had to put a lot of effort into his thinking process. So if you ever forget the definition of scholarship, just turn to him. Before leaving you today, I would like to leave you with this note. Do not ever do anything to show off, just so people can glance on the surface and applaud for you. Do not do it for them. Do it for yourself. Go beyond and push yourself to the higher level. Because the only thing that can limit your capability is yourself. Thank you.
Thank you, Aitan. I would now like to present Faith Coates, who will speak about service.
Congratulations, inductees, for making it into the National Honor Society. You should feel proud of yourself, for it is not an easy feat. You have met all four pillars of this society: scholarship, service, character, and leadership. So as you continue on this journey, let me offer you some words of wisdom to remind you of who you are as a beloved daughter of God. Humans were created by God to love and serve. When we serve others, we reveal who we are and for whom we work, God. Saint Pope John Paul II said, "The best way to find yourself is to lose yourself in service to others." The National Honor Society acknowledges this beautiful fact. The Society of Scholars and Leaders wants to make clear the importance of giving back to our communities. You, as young women, are made in the image and likeness of God, and are called to share your gifts. This is the reason why service is one of the pillars of the society. We give up of ourselves and encourage others to do the same. One important lesson to learn while in NHS is one we've also learned in morality class. When we love others, we find a heavenly joy that is within us. We find this joy because we are called to serve others and do everything according to God's will. But as John Donne says, no man is an island entire of itself. Each man is a part of a continent, a piece of the main. He means that no man is separate from others. No man lives in isolation. When we serve, we want people to know that they are not alone in their sufferings, and which will help them flourish. When a woman gives of her time and energy to another person, she is helping both the community as well as that individual. We show these individuals that their well-being is more important than our time. Our service shows that they are not alone in this world, and we genuinely care. Now, it is one thing to do service to get into NHS, but now you're going to be asked to do even more service. When being inducted to NHS, it is important to have the understanding that other people need us. The NHS has helped our community by teaching elementary school students, singing to the elderly, working in the food pantry, and making cards for kids in hospitals. When we go and help our local community, it's important to have the right attitude about service. The people we help can see whether we truly want to help them or we're doing it because it's a requirement. So, when you're being inducted today, keep that positive attitude towards helping others, and you'll find that the work, time, and energy you put into service will bring forth fruit. God promises that He will give, that what we give to others will be given back to us tenfold.
It says in Romans 12:1, "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship." And in Luke 6:38, it says, "Give, and it will be given to you." And again, in 1 Peter 4:10, it says, "Each of you should use whatever gifts you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms." So when you uphold the pillar of service, remember that we are called to serve others in ways that will not only help us find ourselves, but also help lead others to the truth. When we live lives of courage and service, others will notice and perhaps be inspired to emulate our efforts and our attitudes. And ultimately, we will live doing the work that is pleasing to God. Thank you. Thank you, Faith. I would now like to present Maria Forbes, who will speak about leadership.
Good afternoon, all, and congratulations, inductees. This is a great accomplishment and one that you will never forget. I'm here to speak about leadership. Someone once said, "Great leaders don't set out to be leaders. They set out to make a difference. It's not about the role, it's always about the goal." Every leader seeks to make a difference in someone else's life, whether it's helping a senior citizen cross the street or leading a sports team to victory. The goal of a leader is to make a difference in a manner that is positive, productive, and inspiring. I would like to look at the word LEAD as an acronym. L, listen, E, encouragement, A, accountability, and D, determination. Leaders are those who are willing to step up and solve problems. When trying to solve problems or reach a goal, a leader needs to listen to those affected by the decision. It is always a good thing to get different perspective on a specific subject. Listening to others can help you come to a better and practical decision. In listening, you are able to see where your peers fall short and uplift them. Every student who is elected into the National Honor Society must be a leader. Some of the ways in which NHS members lead are to contribute to class discussions and to be willing to acknowledge problems that arise and find ways to solve those problems. A leader is one who sets goals. When trying to reach a goal, from getting good grades to winning a game and to getting into college, it is important to remember that everyone may not think as you do. As a result, people can easily get discouraged by the things you may or may not do. When people are discouraged, as a leader, it's important to realize that you must encourage. I remember being on a basketball team, and whenever my fellow teammates would talk, the coach would have us run as a consequence. It was like a motto for the team. We talk, we run. Running when we didn't feel like running was horrible. But in such unpleasant experiences, the team and the coach are able to see who the leaders are. The leaders are those who, no matter how many quarter courts, push-ups, or burpees are asked of them, the leaders are those are ones who continue to encourage others. While barely being able to breathe, they say, "It's all right, you're almost there, you've got this, we've got this." In the toughest situations, they are the ones who stand strong and lend a shoulder to lean on. A leader allows others to see what is possible. We all need a leader like this. They are the ones who can uplift and always be there. Leaders must not only be present, but be accountable. They need to take ownership of their decisions, whether right or wrong. Taking ownership is a tough thing to do in times where the outcome isn't the most pleasant, but taking responsibility will result in you learning from your experience. In June of 2016, I was a freshman about to take my math final. I hadn't studied a lot for this final, even though it was the toughest subject and the subject which I earned my lowest grade. It was not smart, did not follow my footsteps. While I was taking the final, I knew I wasn't going to do well. I wasn't confident in any of my answers. After taking the final, I called my mother and told her how I felt. I told her that I failed the final and that my life was over. She told me that we all mess up sometimes, but I couldn't make the same mistake again. Later on, I got my results and I got a B. The grade wasn't that bad, and my life wasn't over. The moral of the story is that I owned up to the fact that I didn't study and I told my parents. I didn't blame my shortcomings on teachers or on the class. Instead, I used the situation as a learning experience and was determined to study, practice, and do better the following year. Determination can take you far in life. It is what makes the difference between being satisfied with what is and achieving your goal of what could be. As a leader, it is important not only listen to those around you, but to listen and discern right from wrong. There are always going to be people who will attempt to degrade your value. You know the saying, haters gonna hate. You can't let them get you down, so shake it off. As a result, when things don't seem to be going your way, you must be determined to persevere through the trials and rough times you may face. Moreover, as a leader, you must be confident in your God-given ability to lead. In conclusion, leadership does not happen overnight. It is a quality that must be developed like clay. The sculptor must massage and shape the clay before it can